I'm going to speak about using WordPress to test and validate ideas. So I revived a website of mine. It's called W Possible, which is essentially about WordPress for makers. I've been, over the last year, getting more and more into this whole maker space, the idea of quickly validating, and I'll go through some of the why I think that's useful. So this is what I decided to do. I decided to do 4 projects, 7 days. Hopefully to come here to you guys and tell you, great, everything worked out well. That was like 8 days ago. It's been pretty interesting. Those are the 4 projects. First is W Possible, which is WordPress for makers. So what I found yesterday speaking to people is that there's guys who are just starting out with WordPress, and there's guys who are developers, and there's a whole group of people in between. People who are who know enough to be dangerous, who are able to configure plugins, etc. I think that's also, that's kind of the audience that I'm looking for. People are tinkering, trying to get things done affordably and quickly. The second one is called Write Invisible. I mentioned that I was studying, I was having great difficulty actually just writing, so I created a distraction-free writing environment. It's actually quite cool. ThinkWorkers, which is a lead service for indie analysts and small companies, again, solving my own problem as an independent public policy analyst that chooses not to do any government work for fairly obvious reasons around how tenders are adjudicated, etc. I needed to broaden my way of actually getting work. And then Zapreneur, which is really my baby. And I mean, what we essentially want to do is we want to try and create a marketplace for indie stores. I don't know what that means. I actually don't know what that means. So I'm happy for people to come up to me and say, I've got a good idea. We've got a couple of beta people involved in this, testing out a couple of things, etc. So I'm finding it quite exciting. So let's deal with entrepreneurship first, right? Because one of the things I really worry about when I speak about entrepreneurship in the South African context is that, I'm not going to go into all of the data, but it's very, very difficult in South Africa, even in a comparative perspective to other countries, right? So if you look at the GEMS data, the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor data, and the primary reason for this is a very concentrated economy. Now you can worry about the very concentrated economy, it's very important to do that, but you also need to think about how we actually begin to grow this economy and make it more equal. Just in case you guys are interested, I have a whole thesis on this. If somebody's interested, I'm happy to share this. Secondly, hardship is glamorized. Right, so you can go onto Twitter and you can use the hashtags grinding, hustle, you know, I'll sleep when I die, etc. It's all BS, right? It's all BS. Thanks, guys. There's always not a successful outcome. So you need to know this, you have the dream that you're thinking of, you've got to plan also for the contingency that it's not going to be successful. Double stakes if you're a parent, which I am, because you've got to worry about the kids, etc. Right? So use everything I say with caution. This is no manual, this is no great way of doing things, it's not the answer. I'm not selling you guys anything. Right? So if you spend enough time and spend enough money on the internet, recognize the yellow background with the red border. But those are the psychological tricks. So if you speak to internet marketing gurus, this thing sells like crazy. All you need to do is put a buy button and a PS at the bottom and you're going to get tons of sales. Okay, so this is me in 24. I decided it's time to actually do something with WordPress. I've been using WordPress since before Kubrick was the default theme. It was actually called, I think it was called WP Classic or something like that. Look more uglier than Kubrick. But anyway, that's me in 2014. I said, let me start doing something. I need to transition from being a freelancer into actually developing products. So I put together a bit of money. I had lots of time. And that's me after about 6 or 7 months. I ended up, and I was running proposal desk. Having spent all the money I put in there, all the time, not a successful outcome, right? I did have sales. I was not just able to scale this thing. But it's not a linear process, right? So it's not like you're just doing one thing. So you start out by like checking out 20 themes, right? You buy the really expensive theme because it's going to like sort out your schema. It's going to integrate with this, right? Then you figure, yo, I need to have like an opt-in box. So you need to check out plugins, right? Then you obviously, because there's so much choice in the WordPress, you create the spreadsheet, the last spreadsheets, with like a million categories across the thing. Right? And then obviously to get the plugin, you need to put some more money in. So you buy plugins, right? And at the end of the process,
You end up with no money,
no product,
lots of wasted time. FML, because I'm trying to sound like a millennial. But I mean, that's the reality of a lot of people. And I say this with experience because I've been in Zambia, I have 8 years of experience engaging with autonomous. So it might not be WordPress, it might be something else. Maybe you're buying mailing lists, right? Maybe you're putting down money for training. It's obscene when people train, charge for training. You're developing this system, that system. Right? So not a train smash, I learned a ton of things. Biggest learning that I had is I'm really good at CSS now. Really, really good at CSS, right? And it's actually very helpful. Not so bad, I had an affordable loss, I had an X amount of money. I did put in a little bit more in there, but I didn't like lose my shirt. I mean, I wasn't like completely the stuff. So this is a key learnings. I'm not gonna really go through this except to highlight the last 3 points, right? One is to focus on inputs. That's what I learned, is to focus on what's in your control. In other words, your time, your money. That I think is more important than focusing on the output. That spreadsheet that you have calculating monthly recurring revenue is nasty. It's beyond your control. What you have in your control is what you can do every day and your resources. Secondly, is to test many ideas. Okay, I know this is what I mean is a very experienced way, it's doing all at once, but you need to test them quickly. You can't spend like 6 months on this idea, you'll do like a week. If you go onto this very interesting site called Twitch, which is mostly for gamers, over the last like 4 weeks, there have been people like every weekend doing 3-4 hour startups. Very, very interesting to watch the process unfold. One of them, I'll come to a little bit later, but one of them, which you guys might be interested, it's called I Don't Need WordPress, right? Which actually uses your Google Docs to actually create a blog. Fascinating, except the guy's main website, which is called Startup Stories, actually runs on WordPress. But I mean, it's like 24 hours this guy did this stuff. It's pretty amazing. Secondly, be less lonely. You need to join a group, some sort of group. And I'm very glad to find WordPress, South Africa Slack group, so I joined something called WorkChat. It's called Work in Progress. So it's made up of all people that are makers, bootstrappers, etc. Don't feel weird. I mean, I don't fit in there. I'm like, they're all like nomad dudes, etc. But I'm learning a hell of a lot. I mean, it's like exponential learning over a period of time. Work with others. I mean, Zuleid is my friend. We work together on a lot of stuff. I bounce ideas off him. And your family and friends. Amazing what resources you actually have. So that's my story. Let's just bring it up a little bit more context, a little bit higher level.
So this is WordPress. You know, in 2003, that's a very scooping theme, the default theme. I mean, at that point in time, we were thinking about if you had a magazine theme, it was like totally cool. I mean, for me, I spent endless hours working with something called Morning After. I don't think anybody knows the theme called the Morning After. Okay, so it's like the most awesome thing ever. It's not only even on WordPress.com, and I was hacking this thing. There was a guy in Germany who used to do tutorials every week and stuff. There's no one around. Around 2008, the screenshot is of a theme called the Gumball Special. Another interesting theme at the time. But what it was actually, it was about getting magazine-type themes into the space. Also about the time that you had the companies like WooThemes, Studio Press coming up, Gravity Forms, etc. Now you're here in 2018. We have a customizer. We're able to sell products. We're able to do lots of stuff, courses, etc. I'm not sure what Gutenberg means in all of this going forward. I tried it out. I kind of like it, not like it, etc. But it's a way that's going. But there is a big question here around the direction of WordPress going forward that I want to raise. So the second slide says, in the startup world, while this is happening in WordPress, what's happening actually in the startup world, right? In the beginning, a little bit before 2003, before the dot-com bubble, it would say if you build it, they will come. And I just had to get some presentation first. But that was really the mantra. It was, let's scale this thing, let's go, this internet's going to be huge, and everything crashed. Once it crashed, people started to think about it, think about what can we do better. And what they came up with was something called the Lean Stack. Right, so I actually used that Lean Stack when I ran a proposal desk, which is the thing that actually didn't work out. And basically what it said is that you need to first sort out your market, right? Sort out what your market wants, understand their problems, etc. Once you understand that, you actually build the product. The idea being is that you wouldn't waste your time building something that nobody wanted, and that's a fit. So I think that's great for some organizations, but if you're a solo entrepreneur, in my experience, maybe somebody else implementing, maybe a better implementer, you might have a better outcome. I think you're gonna end up losing both your money and wasting your time.
That's my own opinion.
Right, so if you look at the sort of the lean stack, the main book at that time called The Four Steps of Epiphany, it goes through like about, I don't even know, it's like more like 67 big steps. Each of those steps has smaller steps. It was simply not executable in a lot of ways. And I lost support. I think I
did it reasonably okay. And now I've discovered this thing called MAKE, which is like a different sort of approach to doing things. Much less complicated, a lot more risky. You also need to be a lot more adventurous. And that's what I kind of want to speak to about here. But first, we need to deal with one of
the biggest issues that people have. That's about focusing your own ideas. So I have a huge problem. When I can think about ideas like this earlier. So you guys might be thinking, four ideas is crazy. That's actually a short list of I don't know
how many.
And it kind of looks something like this. I mean, there's like a whole lot of stuff going on. The criteria that you want to use. So, is there a pain point? Can I get recurring revenue? Is there a market? Can I build a product? Do I have a passion for it? The expertise? There's a competition in the market. So, you want to do things like Ethereum must need to get total addressable market, etc.
That's way too complicated, right? So, I think for me, you need to look at three things. One is there a customer?
Right? And are you solving something that's real? Do you have the skills on your own, in my opinion, to actually build this thing? So when the greatest respect to designers and developers in the room, if you have a budget, let's say on a top end, somebody who's working on about like 50,000, you don't have the money to hire a good developer or a designer. You also don't want to take the risk of using marketplaces, etc., because you're going to spend a lot of time. So it's just my skill.
And the third thing is, are you having fun? There's a project that I ran, which essentially focused on getting tenders electronically to people, which sounds like a great market. I wasn't having fun in this because I personally was not involved in that space, right? So that's just a way of summarizing it, just so that we can get a picture of this. If you're in point four here, I don't have a point four. That's like a sweet spot. That's where you want to be. Point three, if you're having fun and you have customers, this is like a marketer's delight. So I've seen a lot of people who are really good at marketing, able to scale this thing, do pre-orders, and then be able to actually outsource development. So that might be an option. If you're having skill and customers, you might as well be working someplace. You know, because it's, without being disparaging to people who are working full-time or whatever, I worked full-time in the trade unions. I enjoyed it up to a point, and then it was like, no, man, this thing isn't for me.
And if you're having skill, if you have the skill and you're having fun doing it, it's a hobby and that's great.
You know what I mean? Maybe that's all you need to do. This is about filtering your ideas. So I'm not saying you can use this. But what I am saying is that reduce the complexity of the criteria you use to select the idea. That's the important thing. For me, it's this. I mean, for you, it might be something else. But I think if you go above three, the complexity, the mathematics is a hell of an interesting, because I actually found a calculator, so for every one you add in there, it just like increases like exponentially, the number of possible iterations there are here. Step two is to build quickly, all right?
Okay, so this is WordCamp. I love WordPress. I've been involved in WordPress forever. It's not the only option, right? There's host platforms and hacks aplenty. We'll go through a couple of them. So what I've seen in a lot of the stuff, people are linking up something called Card, which is awesome, and Airtable, you can actually run a mini membership website on that. It's actually awesome, and it's almost free. Almost free, you can actually do it like really cheaply. If you're doing courses, there's things like Teachable, Podeo, Thinkific, also hosted platforms. Products, obviously, Shopify is huge in South Africa as well. Blog, you have things like Ghost, and there's a whole lot of other stuff here. So it's not only WordPress. You need to find the mix of stuff that you're going to do. But I think WordPress still, even if I look at all of these options, because I've done that, I think WordPress has something to offer that's probably better than all of these. First thing is your platform.
Your name, your company name before that. Right? You can't get it in Teachable, etc.
So what you find out with a lot of people is they have a WordPress blog and they run the courses of Teachable. Totally understand it because learning management system plugins, I believe in the WordPress space, are completely outpriced. In my opinion, they're outpriced, but also I think they do too much. So there's a wide range of well-supported solutions.
It might be a bit more expensive in the beginning, but for instance, if you want to do a job board, there's something called WP Jobs Manager.
Awesome plugin, awesome support, automatic, the company that owns WordPress uses that. Go to a membership site.
There's tons of them. I mean, paid memberships pro. It also, I'm not mentioning because it has some integration with PayFast, but there's other options. The third point, I think, it enables a range of user experiences. So if you want one of these hosted platforms, pretty much stuck into how they do things, which might not be the best thing for you, might not be the best thing for your students. There's a wide range of integrations, right? And you use what works. I just warn you. I mean, trying to get integrations going on a WordPress site, you can spend hours, days, months even. It's like a rabbit hole. You might not ever return.
The most important thing, I think, is that it allows you to create a platform. So you can go from a blog to a membership site, maybe using some adverts.
So you're able to stack it up over a period of time.
Right.
And the final point is it allows you to build your own. There's a huge amount of confidence in seeing this thing work, seeing it out in the world. Right, okay, so now we get time for the acronym.
This thing got a bit funny in the roster. This is a Boots framework, right? So I kind of way of summarizing this thing because it's just like, you can go all over the place. And I did this last night, it's called a Boots framework, right? So B is for because, why are you doing this thing? O is for originality, putting it in inverted commas because we don't want to get too hung up on innovation, etc. So for example, if you're doing a low-cost segmentation of something that exists, so I'm thinking like maybe a learning management system plugin. If you go in there and do a, if you're a developer and you do a cheaper learning management system plugin, I'd probably be interested in buying it. When someone said yesterday, Rayfield mentioned Yoast. Yoast is great. I mean, I've used it. I've bought the premium version, etc.
But I discovered something called SEO Press. That's like $39 a year for unlimited websites. I bought the thing. I'm giving the thing a go. It seems to be working. So what that guy has done is awesome. He's giving you unlimited plugins
at a low cost price. And it's essentially what people call a low cost segmentation strategy. Right? So I mean, there's lots of things that you can do in terms of vision. But the important thing needs to be solutions. You need to be actually solving something. Right? You need to be actually solving something,
and you need to have the product done. Right? So that's really, really key. What I'm finding that you cannot be adding on an additional feature, an additional day, an additional language. You just get the product done, see if people are gonna send it out. What's interesting is people are extremely, extremely helpful, and will point out your making mistakes in the nicest possible way, and your customers. It's absolutely brilliant. Nobody will confidence issues. You need all of it or something that's maybe not perfect. Obviously, it can't be done, but it doesn't need to be perfect. It's something that's reasonably good quality, people are gonna support you. Operations, critical. So yesterday we had this talk, I found it very interesting around how you automate your business using some CRM. It's very important to get a funnel going in your business, and finances, absolutely critical. So basically what you're doing is moving from the idea side to the operations. Once you've sorted out the back end of the stuff, right, you're then worrying about traction, which is the T, sales and validation, and importantly, tracking progress. And then the final one is about scale, right? So what's important here is here you're not selling to hundreds of people. You're maybe not even doing Facebook ads. You're basically selling to a very small group of people trying to see whether people will buy, what pain points are you solving, right? And the scale, there's different types of scale. It's an area that I'm incredibly interested in, both as an entrepreneur, but also as somebody who's interested in public policy. How do you actually take a good project and actually scale it? And then ultimately, you need to make a decision. So like I said, I mean, it's about getting through this. I think you can get through this entire loop if you have most of the product done in about 7 days, right? You're gonna work long hours. I was gonna use another word, but you're gonna work long hours. Right? Let's get back to WordPress. What does this all mean? Using WordPress effectively. Number one, use managed hosting, WP hosting. It's a very expensive, right? They deal with a range of issues for you. Security, caching, and at least from the ones I use, the hosting staff are often more knowledgeable about what you need to do than the plugin people. And they also don't have a vested interest to actually sell you anything. I use it tremendously. I mean, I think the support for me I'm probably like, you know, there's like a, in the back end, there's like the guy who asks lots of questions. I'm probably that guy. I use them extensively and they've been very, very helpful.
Use the default theme and default plugin settings. Right? So I'm building all of the stuff here on 3D16. Default 3D16. Because the minute I go into that theme shop and I start with WordPress and I end up with Elegant Themes and WooCommerce and Studio Press, I'm going to go completely nuts. Because everything just looks so crazy. This uses this, whatever. So, I mean, I'm building it on 2016.
Do not reinvent the wheel. Incidentally, the 2016 thing is not my thing. It's actually a site that Zunaid shared with me. What's the guy called? Page? Okay, I'll get it for you. It's the totally weirdest dude you've ever met in the WordPress community. He believes in not spending any money on any plugins. And he sells you little notebooks around how you don't need to spend money on plugins. Totally fascinating.
Create a reusable stack of plugins and themes. Right? So if you're going to do many projects, try many things, you just need to have a standard set of stuff. I have that. I mean, I'm quite happy with my stack. I know those plugins fairly well. And hopefully they keep in good stead.
Double bonuses if you can get a lifetime membership because you don't want recurring costs, recurring costs going forward. Build a funnel. That's absolutely critical. Right? So you need a way of automating this thing to some extent. As a solo person, you ain't going to be able to run around doing customized service. I want to do that. And I'm sure all of you guys want to do that. But you need some level of automation. Link it with your operating system, so things like email marketing, invoicing, etc. Very important is use a local install. Right? So I've broken stuff. Like the day I needed to launch. I just like, yo, this whole thing is like wrong. Fortunately, most have something called restore. Right, so I've learned that you need a local install. And so that's about using WordPress effectively. What about ineffectively?
50 shades of green. Learn CSS changes. I spend literally,
I've got 5 minutes left. I spend literally days upon days actually looking for the right color of green because it just needed to contrast the right way. Don't be a wannabe font geek because that's the other thing that I want to do is that I want to put in Google fonts, etc. Just go with the default stuff. You're going to get out of this here. Don't be a security ninja. You're not. In my honest opinion, humbly, I don't understand the security plugins. It's beyond my level of comprehension. Those settings, etc. I mean, I've, for instance, been locked out of my website. I outsource it to the hosting guys. They sort it out. And they're doing a fairly good thing. The other thing which I see people now doing is null anything. When I've been speaking to people, and people will offer you, even in South Africa, it's quite good, like in a coffee shop, WordPress, whatever, people will offer you. Now I have this thing, they're like, okay, do you know what you actually got? And they're like, no. It's found for free on the internet. There's some bad stuff in that code. Don't actually do that. So forget tailored, forget customized on your website. What you need to be doing is you need to be tailoring your product, your service to your customer. It's a key mindset. Now we come to whether you can scale this thing or not. So you spend maybe a week, 2 weeks actually testing this thing out. I'm still figuring this thing out. I was supposed to have been done by yesterday. I was going to present this great thing. Say that I did 4 projects, 7 days, cool dude. I'm still figuring out whether I'm going to scale this thing or not. But I will be because I'm going to blog this whole thing and people can follow on. So this is like a three quick things. One is that I think it's very important to sort out your ideas. Right, into sequence there. So what I find with a lot of people, solopreneurs, particularly if you're in services, try to transition to consulting or building a product, you're like wearing two hats and you add like two projects on there. You need to like sort out exactly what it is that you're going to do. Secondly, go for the sale. I'm a very, very reluctant salesperson. Right? And that's part of the reason why I didn't make so much money on it. I ran it for 6 months on a beta, etc. I had like hundreds of users, but I wasn't actually making any money off this thing. And then the final thing is, I hope you guys actually reach a point where you're able to scale it. But if you don't manage to reach the point where you're going to be scaling, you wouldn't have spent a year doing this thing, and you wouldn't have spent tens of thousands of rands doing this thing. You might have spent like a few thousand rand, and it's a month, it's an excellent learning experience, and you get ready for the next one. That's kind of like the maker philosophy. So,
If you guys want, you can go to wpossible.com/yet-another-wordpress-newsletter. Sign up. If I'm launching anything, I'll put in a code there saying WordPress WordCamp Johannesburg. If you guys are interested in
any of the products. And yeah, thank you so much for the invitation and thank you for listening.